module 1, which is introduction to operating system. Okay, let me just open the module 1 notes. Yes, introduction to operating system. See, a very simple definition to our operating system is, it is a software which will manage all other softwares that are running in a computer system. Okay, so very simple definition. It is a software. Operating system is nothing but a software which will manage all other softwares, okay, that are running on a computer, on a PC, on or a laptop, on or a mobile phone, or on a embedded system. Because operating systems can be employed in PCs, as we know. So every personal computer that you use will have a OS. It is normally Windows. Okay. So operating system can also be employed in mobile phones. Okay. So common system, common OS is Android. Okay. And another example is iOS. Some might use iPhone. So there the operating system is iOS. Then operating system can also be employed in embedded systems. Okay, so an example for embedded system is an ATM machine. Okay, the machine from which you draw the amount. Okay, ATM machine, there also an OS is installed. Okay, so like this, operating systems can be installed in all such systems where the management is important. Okay, management is necessary. Okay, so before actually jumping into operating system, first we shall talk about a scenario, okay, where you will understand what is the use of our OS and what the OS actually does. Okay, so I'll take this scenario. So it is a very simple scenario. It is a scenario of a restaurant. Okay, it is a scenario of a restaurant wherein, so let's say you go to a restaurant. So there are four tables. Okay, so table 1, table 2, table 3 and table 4, I have labeled them as T1, T2, T3, T4. Okay, so let's assume that all the four tables are occupied. Okay, all the four tables are occupied. Suppose you want to place an order. Let's say table 1, T1, he wants to place an order. Okay. At the same time, table 2 also wants to place an order. Table 3 also wants to place an order. Table 4 also wants to place the order. So simultaneously, all the four tables are trying to place the order. Okay. See, one thing is for sure, whenever you are in a restaurant, you cannot directly go to the kitchen and take whatever you want and eat. Okay, so agreed, everyone knows that you do not have direct access to a kitchen of any restaurant. Okay, if you want to eat, you have to place an order, then only that will be served to you. Remember that. Okay, so no table has direct access to the kitchen. Okay, agreed with this? So this access is not there. So table 3 also does not have direct access to kitchen. It is similar to table 2 and table 4 also. Okay, so what you want to do, so if you want to eat something, you have to place an order. Okay, now the scenario is all the four tables simultaneously want to place the order. So what they will do, so they will call out the server. Okay, they will call out the server. But if you call out the server, so before the server attends you, there will be a supervisor. Okay, there will be a supervisor. So I have indicated that using capital S here. So this particular guy is a supervisor. So S stands for supervisor, or you can also call him as a manager. So in any restaurant, okay, in a large restaurant, there will be a manager or a supervisor. So as soon as the tables want to place the orders, this supervisor, okay, or the manager, they, what he will do is he will send a server to attend the table. So he will send S1 server to attend T1. He will send one more server, S2, to attend T2. He will send one more server, S3, to attend T3, and he will send one more server, S4, to attend table T4. So who will send these servers? The manager or the supervisor, which is indicated using capital S. So at the center, you can see the supervisor is sitting here. So who will take care of the management? Okay, so he will manage the servers. So whenever a table calls, so he will send a particular server to that particular table. Okay, fine. Then what they will do is, so this each table will place the order. Okay, each table will place the order. So since this supervisor has sent the server to that table, so once the order is placed, this server comes back to the supervisor. Okay, so this S1 comes back to the supervisor and he will tell that table 1 has placed so and so order. Okay, similarly, this S3, okay, so this S3 will also come and report to S. So after the order is placed, similarly, S4, the server 4 will also be coming and reporting to the manager, S, and S2 also will come and report to manager. So all these servers come and report to the manager saying that these tables are placed so and so order. Now the manager or the supervisor, he will send these orders to the kitchen. So all the orders are aggregated and he will send the orders to the kitchen. Okay, getting this? Once the orders are prepared, okay, and they are ready to be served, so they will be sent back from the kitchen to this supervisor or the manager. And again, the supervisor or the manager, he will distribute the orders to individual tables through the servers, S1, S2, S3, and S4. So very simple operation. Fine? Any doubts here? Guys, any doubts here?
No, sir.
No, sir.
Yeah, this is the basic model of operating in operation of a restaurant. Okay. Same concept will apply for operation of a operating system. Okay, very simple. So whatever the supervisor is doing here, okay, the supervisor or the manager is doing, this is nothing but the OS. So this is the job of the OS. Okay, so you can map, instead of a supervisor, it is the OS that will take care of this. Okay, so what is the job of the OS? So as soon as a table here, so T1, T2, T3, T4, they will call out to place order, this operating system will be notified that so and so table is trying to place order. Okay, so now instead of table, what I'll do is I'll rename this tables as P1, P2, okay, P3, and P4. So instead of tables, I've renamed them as P1, P2, P3, P4, indicating that these are the programs. So program 1, program 2, program 3, program 4. So whenever a program wants something, okay, whenever it wants to access the hardware, okay, whenever it wants to access the hardware, so hardware in this sense, in any PC or in any system, hardware means it can be the CPU means the microprocessor, okay, because without microprocessor no job can be completed. Okay, so for a program or a software to run, it should have access to the microprocessor or the microcontroller, which is nothing but the CPU. So hardware of a PC or a system means it is CPU, it is the memory, okay, it can be an IO device. Okay, these are the hardwares. Okay, so assume that these hardwares, CPU, memory, and IO devices, they are nothing but they are present in the kitchen. Okay, so kitchen is nothing but the hardware, underlying hardware of a system or a PC. Okay, so instead of kitchen, it is hardware. Okay, so instead of tables, it is programs, P1, P2, P3, P4. And instead of the supervisor or the manager, it is the OS. So whenever a program, P1, it wants to access the kitchen in the sense, the hardware. So what do you mean by hardware? It wants to access a CPU or a memory or a device. Okay, it cannot directly access the kitchen, or it cannot directly access the hardware. No. So if it wants to access the hardware, it has to go through the operating system only. So what it will do is, this program P1, it will raise a request. Okay, it will raise a request saying that I want to access the kitchen or I want to access the hardware. So as soon as the request is raised, the operating system will come to know the request is raised by so and so program. So what it will do, it will send a server, as I told. In the previous example, I told that it will send a server, S1. So here, it will not send a server. There will be a programs there will be programs which are nothing but OS programs which will be running, which will take care of the requests. Okay, they will take care of requests. So OS, what it will do, it will intimate the programs which will take care of the request, saying that P1 has raised the request. So OS will attend the program P1 and it will ask the P1 what you want in the kitchen. Okay, that means what you want to access in the hardware, whether you want to access the CPU, whether you want to access the memory, or whether you want to access the IO. Okay, so P1 will tell the OS that, yeah, I want to access so and so. So then the operating system, okay, the operating system, then it will go and check whether that hardware is free. And if that hardware is free, it will allot that hardware, or it will allow the access of that hardware to the program P1. Okay, very simple. So this is what OS will do. Okay, so OS will manage. It will manage the entire operation of the computer or a mobile phone or a embedded system. Okay, hope you got the concept. Okay, any doubts here?
No, sir.
Okay.
No, sir.
So now we'll come back. So what is a OS? So simple definition I told. It is a software which will manage all other softwares. Okay, very simple definition. So if you go, if you want a more elaborated definition, so an operating system is a system software, okay, that manages computer hardware, software resources, and provides common services for computer programs. Okay, so this is more elaborated version of the definition. So it is nothing but it's a system software. It's not a third party software. It is a system software that manages computer hardware. The computer hardware, I told. So hardware means CPU, memory, and some IO devices. Okay. Then it manages the computer hardware. It also manages the computer software resources. Okay. So nothing but other programs that are running. Okay. And then it also provides some common services. Which are the common services provided by the OS? We shall see that later. Okay. Can anyone tell me, for time being, any one service provided by the OS? The common service provided by the OS. Can anyone tell me common service, any one common service provided by the OS? Yes? Okay. Can you think of any one service? See, that service you use day in and day out in your operating system, or in your mobile phones. What is that service? As soon as you unlock your phone, yes, as soon as you unlock your phone, so what you will get? What you will get? No one has used mobile phones. As soon as you unlock your phone, what you will get?
Home screen, sir.
Yeah, home screen. See, that home screen is nothing but it's a user interface. Okay, it is known as a user interface. So in that user interface, so all the icons for the various apps that you have installed can be available there. Okay, the shortcuts will be available. Okay, so along with that shortcuts, so other informations can also be displayed, like the battery percentage, okay, whether you are connected to the internet or not, whether you are in airplane mode. Yes, so what is the data speed? If you are connected to internet, what is the data speed that you are using? So everything will be there in that interface. It is known as a home interface or the desktop of your mobile. Okay, so that interface is the basic common service provided by the operating system. So like that, there are various other common services which I'll discuss that later. Okay, so for time being, remember, see, hardware, which I told, CPU, memory, and IO. So the user programs or any other programs, they do not have direct access to the system hardware. Remember this. Okay, if you want to access the hardware, you have to go through the OS only. You have to go through the OS, right? So can anyone tell me, why is this arrangement like this? Why can't you directly give access to the hardware to any program? Can anyone tell me why not directly give access? See, example, why not directly give access to this table one to the kitchen? What will happen if you give direct access to the kitchen? Nothing will happen. Yes. Tell me. See, these concepts are very close to the real life scenarios. Okay, operating system concepts are very close to real life scenarios. So what happens if you give the access to a kitchen of a restaurant to the customers directly? What will happen? What will happen?
Crowds.
Yes.
Will create some sort of crowds, sir.
Yeah, it will create crowds. Fine. Okay. So it is crowds. Why? Because everyone will rush to access the kitchen. Okay. And then. Won't there be security issues? Won't there be security issues? Sir. Yes, because anyone can access the kitchen, right? So out of the customers that are attending, so they can directly go to the kitchen and they can take whatever they want. And in worst case scenarios, they can corrupt the food. Okay, so they can corrupt the food there. So they can mix, let's say, some ingredient which is not required to some food, okay, which may lead to health issues, okay, for other customers. Yes or no? Yes.
Yes.
Yeah. So, yes, so in total, you can say it is a total chaos. Okay, it is a total chaos wherein, If you allow anyone to access the kitchen, okay, so they can do whatever they want in the kitchen, okay, and they can corrupt the kitchen system. So they can, you can say, damage the whatever the groceries there, okay, they can damage the items available in the kitchen, okay, and finally, they can corrupt the food itself, okay, they can spoil the food itself, so that it will result in health issues for other customers. Okay, so totally it is chaos in the kitchen. So that is why, so now instead of kitchen, it is hardware, and instead of customers, it is programs. So that is why a program is not given a direct access to the hardware, because the program can go to the hardware and it can corrupt the hardware. Okay, it can corrupt the hardware. So if the hardware is corrupted, okay, then all other programs that are utilizing the hardware will also get corrupted. The programs, they will not be able to run properly because the main hardware, the main kitchen, is corrupted. Getting what I'm saying? So that is why direct access is not given to the hardware. So remember this, in any system, okay, any program will not directly be given the access to the underlying hardware. Okay, so that is what is shown in this next following diagram. So you can see a user is there. Okay, user. Okay, so user means some user program he wants to run. Okay, that is what is user. And you can see the computer hardware. Okay, can you see the computer hardware? So this is in between the user and the hardware. Okay, or you can say these are the customers and this is the kitchen. Okay, this is the kitchen and this is the customer. So a customer is directly not given access to the kitchen. Okay, so a user cannot directly access the computer hardware. So within this, between the user and the computer hardware, there will be a managing system which is known as an operating system. This is the operating system. Okay, so what this operating system will do, see here, first thing it will do is it will provide a user interface. Okay, user interface, as I told, user interface. So example, so I'll show the user interface here. So this is my user interface, Windows 10 user interface, correct? In this user interface, what do I have? So I have a start button. Yes. So I have a shortcut for the apps that I have installed, correct? So whatever the apps that I have installed, I have the shortcut for that. Okay. Suppose I want to change the desktop, the screen, wallpaper. So if I right click, so I'll get the options, okay, to personalize or change the desktop background. Okay. So what else I have? Here I have the applications that are running in background. Okay. So Windows security app. See. And what else I have? So in this interface, I have the notifications. Okay. Notifications like this. This is the interface that Windows 10 provides. Right. So like that, each OS will have its own interface. Okay. So an Android interface is completely different from the whatever the Windows interface, right? Like that. So this is a user interface using which the user can interact with the operating system. So this interface is to interact with the operating system. The user will communicate to the OS saying that this is what I want. Okay. This is what I want and make it happen. That is what the user will communicate to the OS. Example. See, suppose I want to open this recycle bin. Okay. So how will I communicate to the OS saying that I want to open the recycle bin? How will I communicate?
Double click.
Yeah. So I'll point the mouse pointer onto this shortcut of the recycle bin and I'll double click. Okay. So as soon as the double click, so the OS will understand that. Okay. What it will understand? It will understand that I want to open recycle bin. So it will open the recycle bin for me. Okay, so this is what the user interface does. Okay, so it will give you an interface to communicate with the OS. Fine. Any doubts here? Any doubts?
No, sir.
Okay. So now we will move on to the next one. Non-kernel routines. So what do you mean by non-kernel routines? Okay, and after that, kernel routines. See, kernel routines are purely OS routines. Okay, they are purely OS routines. So these are the programs that are run by the OS itself. Okay, so example I'll give. See, suppose in your mobile phones, let's say your mobile phone is having 4 GB of RAM. Okay, usually nowadays it is 4 GB, 6 GB, and 8 GB. Minimum is 4 GB for everyone. So out of 4 GB, if you go to the memory management and check how many GBs is free out of 4 GB RAM. Okay. So whether all the 4 GB will be free?
No, sir.
No. Okay. So it can be out of 4 GB, 1.5 GB is free or 2 GB is free. That's all. Okay. But then what about the remaining 2 GB? What about the remaining 2 GB? Tell me. Yes. See, out of 4 GB, already the 2 GB is already being utilized by the OS. Okay, it is already being utilized by the operating system to run various services that it provides. Okay, so example, one of the service it provides is the interface. As I told, it is also known as graphical user interface, GUI, or in short, it is known as GUI, graphical user interface, GUI. Okay, so this GUI in to provide this graphical user interface GUI, it will the operating system will run a service for this. So it will run a service means it will run a program for this. Okay, so this program is completely run by the OS. So since it is running this program to provide the graphical user interface, so obviously this program will consume some memory. Okay, so that is why out of 4 GB, already 2 GB is being utilized, and this 2 GB is utilized by the OS to provide various services that the user needs. Okay, so such programs that are already running by, which are running by the OS, such programs are known as kernel services. Okay, so some of the examples of kernel services are process management, okay, scheduling, memory management. So see, these are all the programs or the processes which are already running, and they are run by only the OS. Okay, they are run only by the OS, and hence it will consume some amount of memory of your operating memory, which is the RAM. Okay, so that is why you will not find all the 4 GB of your RAM memory is free. even though you are not running any application, still, if you can see the memory management, only 2 or 2.5 GB out of 4 GB will be free. The remaining is already being utilized by the OS. So such services which are run by the OS, which are essential, are known as kernel services. Okay. So next, so you can see user interface, non-kernel routines. So these routines implement user commands concerning execution of programs. Okay, and use of computer resources. They are invoked by user interface. Okay. So as I told, so as soon as you double click on the recycle bin, so to open the recycle bin, one routine or one service will be invoked, which is known as non-kernel service or routine, which will which is invoked by the user interface. So as soon as you double click, it will be opened. And what it will do is it will open the whatever the recycle bin, because that is what I wanted to open, correct? Like that. So these are the, you can see, this is the basic abstract view of an OS. So user, so view, so after the user, there will be a user interface. So after the user interface, there is a non-kernel routines. So these non-kernel routines are nothing but the programs of the user only. Okay, so suppose the user wants to play a song, so he will start a particular player. Okay, an MP3 player he will start. So to whenever he starts the MP3 player, the program starts to run. So that program is nothing but the non-kernel routine. Okay, it is not a OS routine, it is a user routine, because user has opened that program. Okay, it is a third party program. It is not a OS program. He has installed it from somewhere and he wants to open that program. So which is nothing but the MP3 player. So as soon as he opens it, a program will start to run. So that is nothing but the non-kernel routine. So after that, there are kernel routines. So these are completely managed by the operating system to provide the services. So as I gave the examples, memory management, process management, scheduling, okay? Then communication. So communication, I told the examples. Message passing, right? So how the programs communicate with each other using message passing. So those services are included in the kernel, which are very important. Okay. Yeah, so this is the abstract view. Okay, so hope you are getting the concept of a OS. Okay, any doubts here? Any doubts?
No, sir.
Okay, so one more thing you have to remember. So as soon as you open an application, so say example, so I want to open this Microsoft Edge application. So as soon as I double click on this, okay, as soon as I double click, so a program, so in order to execute this program, okay, in order to execute this program, a process will be created. Okay, we shall see what is a process later, but for time being, remember, as soon as I double click this shortcut to run this program, so what is the program? Microsoft Edge, it is the program. In order to execute this program, a process will be created, which will take care of the execution of this program, which is the Microsoft Edge. Okay, so remember this. So whichever program you want to execute, whenever you start to execute it, okay, a process for corresponding program will be created. As soon as a process is created, it will be allocated a memory in your operating memory, which is the RAM. Okay, so always remember, RAM is your operating memory or the primary memory, wherein all your programs that are currently running will be loaded. Okay, so that is why the operating memory should be more in order to support more programs concurrently. Okay, in order to support more programs concurrently. See, example. So again, if I come back to your mobile phones itself, see, suppose a 4GB mobile phone, so 4GB RAM it supports, it is installed with 4GB RAM. Suppose you open 10 applications, okay, and you want to switch between the applications, okay, using the recent tab. So in your mobile phone, so you can switch between the various applications that you already opened, right? Since it is 4GB of RAM it is having, so it has some maximum capacity. Okay, so let's say 10 programs. So if you open the 11th program, okay, so the previous in the previous 10 programs, any one program will be stopped. Okay, and that space will be given to this new program, the 11th program that you will open. Okay, that is how the operating system will function. Okay, so So the more is the operating memory, which is the RAM, the more simultaneous programs it can support. That's all. Okay. So that is why people go for 6, 8 GB, 12 GB, 16 GB RAMs. Okay. Why? Because more programs can run simultaneously. Okay. More programs can be accommodated in the memory simultaneously. So if there are more programs simultaneously, the user can easily switch between the program that he wants. Okay. Multitasking will be easy then. Okay. Yeah, so next we'll move on to this. Goals of an operating system. So fundamental goals. So there are three fundamental goals. First one is efficient use. Second one is user convenience. And the third one is non-interference. These are the three fundamental goals of any operating system. Okay, so you can say these are the basic set of rules based on which an operating system will be developed. Okay. First should be efficient use. Whatever the operating system you have developed, it should efficiently use the resources. And then next, it has to give user convenience. And then non-interference. Which tells you what each of this means. Okay. So efficient use. Efficient use. What do you mean by efficient use? In general. Can anyone tell me what do you mean by efficient use? In general. Not only OS. In general, efficient use. Tell me. Efficient use.
Food is efficient.
Yes.
Food is efficient, sir.
Food
is efficient, sir. For telling you.
Food is efficient. Okay. What do you mean by efficient use in general? Okay, I'll give an example. Okay. So suppose there are two brothers. Okay. So B1 and B2. Two brothers are there. Okay. And there is only one, let's say, bicycle. Okay, there is only one bicycle. There are two brothers. Both want to use this bicycle. Okay, both want to use the bicycle. So both cannot use the bicycle simultaneously. Agreed with this?
Yes, sir.
Yes. So what will happen is, so there will be a operating system between these two brothers. Can anyone guess what is this operating system?
Parents.
Yes.
Time.
Exactly. Parents. Okay. So the parents are the operating system between these two brothers. So both the brothers want the bicycle, but both cannot have it simultaneously. Then these OS or the parents, what they will do is they will allocate a time slot. Let's say half day, brother one, B1 will use the bicycle, and the next half day, B2 will use the bicycle. Let's say for the first half, B1, brother 1 will get the bicycle, okay, through the OS, through the parents, fine. But yeah, once he gets the bicycle, okay, for the first half of the day, okay, so let's say the first half of the day is around 8 hours, okay, it is around 8 hours. So for the 8 hours, the complete bicycle is with B1. So out of 8 hours, first half, the brother one, he uses the bicycle for, let's say, 3 hours. Okay. So next, so after the first half is completed, in the second half of the day, again, it is for 8 hours. Okay. So brother two, B2 will get the bicycle. So which will be deallocated from B1, and it will be allocated to B2 using by the parents or the OS. So in the second half, the brother B2, he will use the bicycle for 5 hours out of 8 hours for which the bicycle is allocated to the brother B2. He will use 5 hours. Okay. Now tell me, out of both the brothers, B1 and B2, who has efficiently use the bicycle?
Brother two.
Brother two. Yes, B two. Why? Can you tell me why?
He has utilized more amount of time given to him.
Okay, so let's not say more amount, but out of 8 hours, he has used the bicycle for maximum duration. Okay, which is 5 hours. Okay. So out of 8 hours, he has kept the resource, which is the bicycle, idle for only 3 hours. So out of 8 hours, 3 hours it is idle. So remaining 5 hours, it is being utilized. But in the other case, you can see 5 hours it is idle, but only for 3 hours it is utilized. Okay. So you can say whenever the bicycle is with the brother B1, it is underutilized. The resource is underutilized. Can I say that? Say this. It is underutilized. Okay. And whenever the bicycle is with B2, it is, let's say efficiently utilized. Can I say like this? So this is what you mean by efficient utilization. Okay. So whenever you get a resource, make sure that you utilize the resource for the maximum duration. Okay. So if the resource is, so whenever the resource is allocated to a person or to a program or to a process, okay, and that resource is maximally utilized, then you can say that it is efficiently utilized. Okay. So whenever the resource is with the program or with the process, so as long as the resource is with the program, it should be utilized to a maximum extent. Okay. Then only you can say it is efficiently utilized. Okay. Now, suppose you allocate this bicycle to a, let's say, brother B1, and he will not completely utilize it at all. Let's say he will not utilize it at all. So for the 8 hours, he will not use it for a single hour also. He will just keep the bicycle, idle. So then it is very poor utilization of resources. Agreed with this? Yes. So this is what you mean by efficient use. Okay. So what this efficient use in terms of OS means is the operating system must ensure efficient use of fundamental computer resources. So what are the resources? Computer resources, as I told, memory, CPU, and IO devices. So IO devices like disks and printers. Okay. So poor efficiency can result if, so you can see, program does not use a resource allocated to it. Okay, as I told, brother one, out of 8 hours, if he doesn't use the bicycle at all, okay, so then it is underutilization of resources or poor utilization of resources, which will result in poor efficiency. Okay, so if you allocate a program with a memory, and if that memory or a device allocated will remain idle. If it remains idle, it is a waste of the resource and it is not an efficient use. Getting what I'm saying? So if that is the case, what will happen is such situation may have a snowballing effect. What do you mean by snowballing effect is here. Since the resource is allocated to a program, it is denied to other programs that needs it. Okay, example, as I told. So whenever bicycle is allocated to brother B1, brother B2 will not have the access to bicycle. Okay. Even he has the urgent need for the bicycle, he will not be given the access. Okay. Because it is already allocated to B1. But the problem is the allocated bicycle to B1 is not utilizing it properly. Okay. So this is what is snowballing effect. Say a process or a person wants this resource very badly, but he is denied of this resource. Why? Because it is allocated to some other process or a program. But this program, which has the access to this resource or the bicycle, it is not bothered at all to use the resource. Getting what I'm saying? So this will result in snowballing effect. So someone needs it very badly, but he is not given the resource. Hence, if this person is not given the resource, which he wants very badly, he cannot continue his work. Okay, this person B2 cannot continue his work because he wants bicycle to continue his work, but he cannot continue because this is not allocated to him. It is allocated to someone else, and that someone else is not bothered at all to use the bicycle. Okay, so this is a common problem we face everywhere. Okay, in our society. Okay, someone needs it very badly, but that is not given to him. It is given to someone else who is not at all bothered to use that resource which is with him. Okay, this happens every day. Yeah, so these programs cannot execute. Yeah, so the person who wants the resource, who is not given the resource, they cannot execute. The programs cannot execute because they are denied of the resources. Hence, resources are allocated to them also remain idle. What do you mean by this? See, B2 wants the bicycle very badly, but he is not given the bicycle. Bicycle is given to B1. Fine. So B2 cannot continue because to continue, B2 requires the bicycle. Fine. But this B2, let's say he has also borrowed a helmet. So instead of borrowed, let's say I'll put it as rented. So he has rented a helmet. Okay, so this helmet is already with B2. So this helmet is with B2. Why he has rented a helmet? Because he assumed that the bicycle will be given to him so that he can continue his work. Now the bicycle is not given to him. Okay, then what will happen? This helmet he has rented so that he can use the bicycle. This helmet will also be idle now. This helmet, this other resource, helmet is also a resource. So this other resource will also be kept in idle now. Why? Because in order to use this resource is important. This resource, if you get bicycle only, helmet will also be utilized. If you don't get the bicycle, then this resource, which is helmet, is also idle. Okay? That is what is meant here. Okay, getting this? See, as I told, the OS concepts are very much related to the day-to-day activities that we do. Okay, the day-to-day scenarios. That is how you can easily remember OS concepts. So in addition, the OS itself consumes some CPU and memory resources during its own operation. Okay, this I told. Example is out of 4 GB of space, already 2 GB is taken by the OS itself. Because the OS is also a software, it should also run. So to run a software, obviously it will consume CPU as well as memory. Without CPU and memory, no resource, no software can run. Okay. So this OS itself will also constitute an overhead that also reduces the resources available. Okay, so keep this in mind. Whatever the operating system that you design, the operating system that anyone designs, it is also a software, and it will also consume resources, right? So resources means CPU, it will consume memory, okay? So whoever develops the OS, he has to keep in mind that the resources that the OS will consume, whatever the resources that this OS will consume to run itself, it should be very minimum. Okay, it should be very minimum. Why? Because if the OS itself consumes large part of the resources, okay, if it consumes the large part of the resources, if the OS itself consumes, there will be no resources to allocate for other programs. Let's say for P1, P2, P3 and P4. There will be no resources to allocate. Why? Because OS itself has consumed all the resources. Getting what I'm saying? Yes? It is, if I want to give a simple analogy, so let's say in the kitchen, okay, there is a cook. Okay, so he will prepare some dishes. Okay. So these dishes are nothing but resources. Okay, dishes are nothing but the resources. This cook has prepared the dishes. Okay, so why he has prepared the dishes? To serve to the guests P1, P2, P3, P4. So before serving to P1, P2, P3, P4, if the cook itself eats the majority of the dishes, let's say 70% of the dishes are eaten by the cook itself, so only 30% of the dishes are left to serve to P1, P2, P3, P4. Which is not a feasible solution at all. You get what I'm saying? So here the cook is nothing but the OS, and the dishes are nothing but the resources, and the guests are nothing but the programs. Getting what I'm saying? So the OS should take as minimum resources as possible to run itself. Okay. Yeah. So next thing in efficient uses. Yeah. So how will you come to know whether the allocated resource is being utilized efficiently or not? Tell me. So now you allocated bicycle to B1. So how will you come to know B1 is efficiently utilizing the bicycle? Can anyone tell me? Yes. How will you come to know whether a resource allocated to a person or a process is being utilized efficiently or not? It is a common sense question. Very simple. Yes, whether Chirag is there, Chirag?
Yes, sir.
Okay, Chirag, let's say I have given you 10,000 rupees. Okay, nenne kodidnalla 10,000.
Ah, sir.
No, discount younger, naale 10,000 kodnani vapas. See, let's say I'll assume that I have given 10,000 to Chirag. So now I want to see whether he is efficiently utilizing that 10,000 or not. Okay, so how will I come to know that? Anyone can tell me this? How will I come to know whether he is utilizing that 10,000 properly or not? See, very simple. I have to keep an eye on him. Okay. I have to keep an eye on him. Right. So keep. See, this is a very popular quote. Keep an eye on him. So how many have watched Iron Man 2? How many have watched Iron Man 2? No one?
Yes, sir. Most, sir.
Yeah, so Iron Man 2. Almost so it is a pop. Yeah, almost everyone, but is no one is trying to reply. Huh? See, in Iron Man 2, it is a popular quote where Nick Fury tells to Tony Stark that he has an eye on him. Okay, because he is having only one eye, and that one eye itself is watching Tony Stark. Okay, so that is what his OS will also do to monitor whether a resource is being properly utilized. The OS has to monitor the usage of the resource. Okay, it has to monitor the usage of the resource. So how it will monitor the usage of the resource? It has to keep an eye on the resource. Getting this? Keep an eye on the resource. So examples, I want to see whether this B1 has utilized the bicycle properly or not. Okay. So what I'll do is, or what the parents or the OS, the parents will do is, he will appoint a guy. Okay. These parents will appoint a guy. Okay. Who will keep an eye on this person B1. Okay. To see whether the bicycle is being properly utilized or not. Okay, so the OS or the parents are hiring a guy whose job is only to see whether B1 is utilizing the bicycle properly or not. Yes or no? Understood this?
Yes, sir.
Yes. Okay, so now what is the, so once the parents hire the guy, so the guy will obviously keep an eye on B1 and he will report regularly to the parents or the OS about the status of the bicycle, whether it is properly being utilized or not. Okay. So this is how you can monitor a resource, which will, by monitoring the resource, you'll come to know whether the resource is properly being utilized or not, or it is efficiently being utilized or not. Okay. This is how you can make sure that efficient use is carried out by the program of a resource or not. Okay. But there is a drawback here. There is a drawback. So what is the drawback? Can anyone tell me? What is the drawback? See, the parents are hiring a guy to just keep an eye on B1 so that to make sure this cycle bicycle is properly or efficiently utilized or not. Okay, so since the parents are hiring this guy, so they have to pay something. Okay, they have to pay something, some salary to this guy, correct? So this is the drawback. Okay, so in operating system point of view, if the operating system has to continuously monitor a resource, if it has to continuously monitor a resource, okay, whether it is properly utilized or not, okay, so there will be a disadvantage or there will be a overhead. Okay, why? Because the OS will hire a guy to take care of this to take care of the monitoring. Okay, so this guy that the operating system will hire is nothing but one more service, okay, or one more program. So this is a program created by the operating system only to see whether a resource is, only to monitor whether a resource is properly utilized or not, only to check the resource is properly utilized or not. So hence this is also a overhead. Why? Because the OS is creating a new program or a service to keep an eye on the resources. So since it is creating a new program, again this new program that is created by the OS to just monitor the resources will consume the CPU and memory. It will obviously consume CPU and memory because it is one more program. So if it consumes CPU and memory, again the CPU and memory availability will go down. Okay, the CPU and memory availability will go down. Why? Because again it's a operating system service, so operating system is consuming more CPU and memory, so there will be no resources left to the guests P1, P2, P3, P4, to the programs P1, P2, P3, P4. This is the disadvantage. Okay, so that is what is discussed here. Okay, so OS must minimize the waste. So efficient use of resources can be obtained by monitoring the use of resource and performing corrective actions. But there is a catch. So however, monitoring the use of resources is the overhead. As I told, overhead means extra work of the OS, which will lower the efficiency. Why? Because it will again consume the CPU and memory. Correct? So in practice, what the OS will do is to limit efficient use, it will focus only on few important resources, that is CPU and memory. So hence what OS will do, it will not try to monitor all the resources in the system. It will only concentrate on, important resources, monitoring important resources like CPU and memory. Remaining resources will not be monitored because it will again result in higher overhead to the OS, which will bring down the efficiency. Okay, any doubts here? So this is regarding the first fundamental goal of operating system, which is efficient use. Okay, so we'll talk about user convenience and non-interference in the next class.